etymology of this word is the origin, how this word, this term actually, because in psychology we study it from a scientific point of view, it is a term, and this personality is from the Latin word persona. Persona is the mask what ancient Greek drama artists, players used to wear. By watching the mask, you can immediately judge whether so-and-so person is the king, the other person is the queen, or the prime minister, or whatever roles people play in the theater, that is immediately judged. So looking at a particular physical appearance, you can say, oh, this person is must be a clown, a comedian. So that is how, that was easy for people to recognize by looking at the mask. So the role played by each person in the drama or whatever play they used to enact on, in the theaters, that is the term, that is the word persona indicates. So we go quite often go by the physical appearance to judge a person. Looking at some people, our probably our conscience tells us, oh, this person must be very cruel, or this person must be very generous, very kind, and another person, that fellow must be arrogant. This is how we immediately form some impressions about people going by the physical appearance, or what the old saying says, face is the index of the person. But what your face reveals, reflects, is only very meager amount of your personality. The total personality can never be inferred by facial expressions or how a person physically looks like. So there are very clever, cunning people who pretend to be very generous, kind, but at the heart of hearts, they could be very cruel also. So this is how the modern socialized people do not show their true behavior in their facial expressions. Best examples are the politicians. So when somebody, a political leader gives a public speech, somebody criticizes, and this person, this politician, is not at all. He doesn't show any frownness or anger, and probably with a smile, he might answer that fellow, but his party workers will take care of that person who criticizes. This is how people are not very true to their facial expressions or physical appearance as such. So the psychological part, how you think, feel, behave, interact with other people, that is very crucial part in personality. And before we go to there are some disturbances. Lakalaka, please.
Don't disturb the class.
Yeah, please. Try to avoid as much disturbance as possible. I can understand, because it is online. People have different backgrounds at home. Please see to it that there is no disturbance. Right? Before we go into the details of this intriguing topic, let us just have a look at various schools of thought. Psychology has originated by the works of philosophers, physicists also, psychiatrists, of course, other social scientists like sociologists, anthropologists, even economists. All these sciences have contributed to the growth and the development of psychology. And quite often, I would be pointing out this fact that all these sciences, so-called modern sciences like physics, chemistry, botany, zoology, all these sciences have originated from philosophy. You must be wondering how philosophy could be the root of all these sciences. Philosophy is not actually Vedanta or Tattva or something. In fact, the origin of this term also is very interesting. It's a combination of two words, Philly and Sophy. Philly is love. Sophia is the goddess of knowledge. And it is love for knowledge. Or this is the thirst, the curiosity to know about the world. That is actually what philosophy means. Of course, there are different branches like logic and so on. Even mathematics, metaphysics, all the sciences, those sciences were earlier called as physical philosophies, what today we call physics, chemistry, and so on. They were physical philosophies once upon a time. And botany, zoology, or biology, they were natural philosophies. And as more and more information through research has been accumulated, these sciences have branched off. So now we have so many branches in physics. So like any other field of knowledge, like medicine, those days when in the probably 60s, 70s, and 80s, an MBBS doctor would cure most of the diseases. Those days, PG in medicine was relatively rare. And as more and more medical research has been reported from various parts of the world, medical sciences have separated themselves. So we have advanced the medical fields, endocrinology, neurology, ophthalmology, of course. These are all branches of medical science. And other sciences, engineering, earlier it was only civil engineering and mechanical engineering. It was early in the 60s, 1960s and 70s. Nowadays, we have dozens of branches in engineering, of course. So similarly, psychology also has originated from the works of great philosophers, then contributions from social scientists like sociology, anthropology, economics, psychiatry. All these branches have contributed. So, psychology as a science had started off with some schools of thought. And most of you, all of you know, not most of you, by this time you must be knowing when the first ever psychological laboratory was established. Anybody? I am just...
Yes, in Germany. In Germany.
Very good.
By Dr. William Wundt.
William? Complete name, please. Good. You mentioned the
vaccine, sir.
Huh? No, William wound.
William wound, sir.
Wound.
Yeah. Wound. William wound.
Yeah. Yeah. Americans claim that it was William James who started the first school of psychology, but in the history of psychology, it is Wilhelm Wundt, Wilhelm space Wundt. Wundt. He started the first psychology laboratory in Leipzig University, Germany. And another psychologist who claims that he is the founder of psychology is William James. He started in 1875. Wilhelm Wundt started in 1879. Though William James, he was a medical doctor. William James was a doctor, but he was not interested in medical practice. He was fascinated to study the sensory processes, sensation. And he designed some theoretical papers related to psychology. So that way, if you go back to the basics of general psychology, you study schools of psychology, then biological basis of behavior, then sensation, perception. These are all the processes which are involved in our behavior. So sensory processes attracted William James, and he designed syllabus related to psychology. Then schools of thought. This is actually what I wanted to tell you. Here school doesn't mean it is a hall, it is a building. Need not be. It is, need not be like a laboratory. It need not be a structure, physical structure. If two or more experts, scientists, share the common viewpoint with their approaches, focus of study, similarity of views, one could be in Germany, another could be in America, yet another could be in UK or India. If these people share a common viewpoint about a phenomenon, it could be related to physics, chemistry, psychology, philosophy, whatever it is. So those who agree on some phenomenon are termed as belonging to a school. When Wundt started his first laboratory, he started doing experiments, and he started with a school of thought that gave importance to sensations, memory, and emotions, affective states, they call. So his school of thought was termed as structuralism. That is, the mind has a structure, just like the body. Our body has a structure, of course, head, limbs, other body parts. This is the structure of our body. Similarly, mind also has some structure. It has some components. If body has some organs, mind has certain components or elements. So that way, affective states, images are actually pertaining to memory. These components constitute the background of our behavior. So philosopher says human beings behave because of the soul, but they wanted to make psychology more objective, more scientific. Soul was not accepted. They preferred mind instead of soul. So philosopher said soul, psychologists who wanted to make it more scientific, they substituted the soul with the mind. So mind, you know, the relationship between mind and the brain. Brain is a physical substance. You can see the structure of the brain. When this brain is in action, when it is functional, it becomes mind. So brain receives, stores, transforms all the information, and when necessary, we are able to use that information stored in the brain from the memory. So all our sensations pertaining to vision, sounds, smell, touch, all these sensory knowledge is in the brain. And when this brain is active, functional, it becomes mind. So mind was actually preferred instead of soul. And they said, instead of just saying mind, you specify, okay, I am probably going into, shall we continue with this, or you don't want to go away from this topic?
No, sir. Let us please continue. Go ahead, sir.
Right.
Sir, continue with the syllabus. No, sir. Please.
Please continue, sir. Continue.
Right. I thought these basic inputs are also.
Yeah, I get it, sir.
Important. Yeah, it's a recap, sir, for us. Yeah.
Right. So here, schools of thought, apart from, even from our Wundt started his school of structuralism, American psychologist, Tischner, he was in America, and he was influenced by Wundt's views about human behavior, and he joined Wundt. And these two people claim that it is the structure of the mind which is made up of those three elements that is actually contributing to our behavior. So it is all about our behavior. And many a time, these two terms, behavior and personality, are used synonymously. Of course, there are very subtle differences, but it can be used synonymously. And behavior, the focus of psychology, was actually, till then, it was studying the mind. Then the school of behaviorism, see, this is another school, structuralism. Chronologically, I will just give you the list of some important schools. Structuralism was the most fundamental and basic. Of course, now it is defunct. Then functionalism, that was founded by William James, American psychologist. No doubt he was father of American psychology. He started the school of functionalism. Then psychoanalysis by Sigmund Freud. Then the school of behaviorism. And the roots of behaviorism go back to the works of Ivan Pavlov, Skinner. Then, of course, the champion of behaviorism is Watson. He took the school of thought into applied part of psychology. He's a true champion of school of behaviorism, but the foundations were already laid by Pavlov, Skinner, Guthrie, Thorndike, and all. And later on, the humanism as a school by Carl Rogers, Abraham Maslow, then cognitive school. And there is another school, again, it is a German school called, anybody? German school?
Gestalt psychology.
Very good, very good.
Gestalt psychology school.
Yeah, Gestalt. And founders of this school, Max Wedmer, Kurt Kofka, then Wolfgang Köhler, these three people. Later on, some more people joined, of course, Salman Ash, social psychologist. These people also were influenced by school of Gestalt. We will come to that school also when we discuss the definition or nature of personality. All these schools of thought slightly differed in their perspective to human behavior. And here you must remember, no school of thought is absolutely perfect. And going by that count, no school of thought can be termed as useless or a poor school of thought. No. Every school has its own merit, and at the same time, there are some drawbacks also with all these schools. And see, the study of behavior is very enigmatic. Human behavior is more enigmatic, or probably most enigmatic phenomenon on the earth. So philosophers, when they tried to study plants, they started off with botany from philosophy as a science to study the animals, zoology, to study properties of matter like viscosity, surface tension, gravitation, all those physical concepts like properties of matter. They were specialized by physics as a branch of philosophy, and the different types of rocks, soils, we have geology. And why not a school for studying about humans? If plants, animals need a science, human beings do not need a special science to study about themselves? Yes, that is what psychologists do. And most complex and enigmatic phenomenon is behavior, studying, understanding other people. Not only other people, sometimes we are not aware of ourselves. We don't know what we are. That's why great philosopher Plato said some 2000 years ago, know thyself. First, you know about yourself. Then with that insight, knowledge, you can understand, try to understand other people. So quite often we are frustrated. Shit, I should not have talked like that. I should not have behaved like that. Why? We know what we are, but sometimes we attempt tasks which are beyond our capacity, end up with failure. And many a time we won't learn from failures. Sometimes we overestimate a task or simultaneously underestimate ourselves and miss out certain opportunities. Then we feel really disappointed. I should have attempted. My ordinary guest is very moderate, is ordinary guy. He got into that bank job. If I had tried it, my hand, I would have definitely got it. This is where you probably underestimate yourselves and end up with frustrations. So this is where knowledge of one's own self is very important before you try to understand other people. But as psychology has progressed from the laboratory, now we have applied the fields in psychology. Psychology applied in every walk of life. And so many schools of thought, all these schools have originated because of the complexity of human nature. See, to explain gravitation, you don't need so many theories. One principle, one law, gravitational force, that's all it will explain. Earth has a pulling force. But in psychology, it is very difficult to explain behavior because our behavior, our personality is influenced by so many factors. There are certain factors inside us, and there are certain factors lie outside the situation, the context. They force us to behave in a particular way, and this is where it's very complex. That's why no single theory can perfectly explain our entire realm of human behavior. So many schools of psychology have emerged, and each school has contributed. That way, each school also has defined behavior or personality in its own way. That is where these schools differ from each other. Now, coming back to our concept of personality, the origin just we discussed, and still behavior is what the psychologists focus. The shift from soul to mind was also not satisfactorily accepted by psychologists later on. They said, what type of mind can we study? If mind is worth studying, mind exists in three states: the conscious, the subconscious, or preconscious, both mean the same, and the third is unconscious. Which state of mind is worth studying? And common sense tells us the consciousness is worth studying. Conscious mind, consciousness is the state of mind where we are aware of what is happening now. That means our sense organs provide all the inputs, what you see, what you hear, what you smell. At any given moment of time, you are aware of what is happening around you and inside you also. So this is what conscious mind gives us. And everybody thought, all schools of thought agreed, studying conscious mind makes sense. But Sigmund Freud, way back in 1900, gave a startling view about human nature. And here, was Freud a psychologist? Anybody? It is only a Czech.
Psychoanalyst.
Medical doctor, sir.
Medical doctor? Any other answers? Good, you are giving good response.
Therapist. Neurophysician.
Huh?
Therapist.
Therapist, okay. Any other?
Neurophysician, sir.
Exactly. He was a neurologist. And for political reasons, he wanted to become a physician, doctor. But during the Nazi government, he was an Austrian, close to Germany. During Nazi government's rule, Adolf Hitler annexed Austria, and he belonged to Judaism. The Germans had a negative prejudice, negative attitude towards Jews, and he could not become a doctor. So he shifted to neurology. So he was not a psychologist, basically. He was a neurologist. But his contribution to psychology is enormous. With his school of psychoanalysis, two more psychiatrists joined him. Those days, Jung, Carl Jung, Alfred Adler. These two were, by profession, they were psychiatrists. And Freud has given a very sensational theory of psychosexual development of human nature. And his school emphasized on the unconscious. That's why he was a difference in the faculty of psychology. While all other schools gave importance to conscious mind, Sigmund Freud gave importance, though he admitted conscious mind also plays some role. It is the unconscious mind which dominates our behavior. And to be specific, what is the subconscious? Conscious, you know, you are receiving information from the external world and you are aware of what is happening inside you. You know what is now. That is conscious mind. Unconscious is something I'll tell you later. You know what unconscious means? What is subconscious? Before we go to unconscious, what is preconscious or subconscious? Okay, I'll give some. Pardon? Any answer? Okay. Preconscious or subconscious is, it is about our memory and awareness. If I ask the school where you studied, probably 10th class or whatever, immediately you can gather that information from your mind and just tell me, yes, this is the school where I studied, which town, and probably where did you live, your residence earlier. You can recall where you stayed. Some other city, some other town, some other street. Immediately, this information is at your fingertips. But right now, you are not thinking about that information. That is the difference between conscious and preconscious. In the conscious mind, you are aware of what is happening now and here. The subconscious or preconscious has all the information related to you, but right now, you may not be thinking about that information. So if I ask your parents' name, immediately will tell me. But unless I ask, you have no reason to think of your parents right now. So this is where the subconscious has a lot of information at your fingertips. You can gain access to that information readily. That is subconscious or preconscious. Unconscious here, it has some information. But even if you try, make all your efforts, you scratch your head, pluck your hair, sometimes you fail to gain access to that information. So probably who was the first president of America? Sometimes you may recall instantly. Sometimes you struggle a lot. This is where the unconscious state of mind has a lot of information. It is not actually deleted from your memory system. Only thing is the access problem. You cannot gain access at that moment. Later on, probably instantaneously, it may strike your conscious mind. And the dreams for Sigmund Freud are rich sources of tapping the unconscious. Lot of experiences, desires that we could not fulfill right from infancy through childhood, adolescence till now. There are some unpleasant, bitter, anxiety provoking experiences in our mind because society doesn't permit gratifying those desires. We push that information because we would be punished if we try to fulfill those desires. We try to push it deep into our unconscious state and we comfortably try to forget about that. Better experiences, anxiety provoking. And when we are asleep, during the dreams, those forbidden, repressed or suppressed desires, they float to the surface of the mind in the form of dreams. And dream analysis was very pivotal in Sigmund Freud's theory as well as the treatment. And later on, he used another technique in psychoanalytic therapy called free association as a therapist. But for Sigmund Freud, it was the unconscious which is very important. Conscious mind, though, has some contribution. It is very trivial. Contribution of the conscious mind in understanding behavior or personality is trivial. Conscious mind is very trivial. And that's why he gave the analogy of an iceberg floating on water. Only 1/10 of the mass of the iceberg can be seen on the surface. But the major bulk of the iceberg is beneath the surface of water level. That is actually the unconscious mind. So with emphasis on different objects, these schools of thought tried to explain behavior and personality from its own perspective. That way, the definitions of personality also are pertaining to their schools of thought. And from your syllabus, there are types of definitions discussed in the material. All of you have received the material by now. And here we have amoeba's definition, integrative definition, totality definition. And these definitions, because as I said, one more point, coming to the study of mind, not the soul. Then they said, leave the topic of mind.
How much?
Please maintain silence. So instead of saying mind, they chose mental processes instead of mind. It is a study of mental processes. And the school of behaviorism did not believe in mental processes. Your mind, your thoughts, your feelings, they are subjective. It cannot become a science if you study yours only. The science should focus on objectivity. This is subjective versus objective. Behaviorism wanted to take the school, the subject matter of psychology to close to any other science like physics or chemistry. So they did not accept mental processes. They said behavior. Because what you think, how you feel is your experience, subjective. But behavior, how a person behaves, that is objective. Anybody can see how a person is behaving, interacting. That is how the psychology of the science of behavior has been replaced by mental processes. Because mind and mental processes cannot be studied. If I ask you, do you like a psychology teacher? You say yes. But I can't check whether you are really appreciating or just because no, we have become so sophisticated. We don't want to hurt other people. So yes, yeah, he's good. There is no way to check. So make it more objective. For that, they insisted on objectivity and behavior, because here behavior is actually what you can observe. Why they did not accept mental process was there was no scientific way of measuring mental processes, how your mind is reacting. But with the advent of technology, now we have sophisticated gadgets to study the mind, that is the brain. What is the most advanced technology for studying the mind or the brain? Anybody, please? This is not about psychology.
Is it MRI?
AI, brain imaging,
artificial intelligence. Yeah.
AI, artificial intelligence.
Or MRI.
Yeah. Yeah. Idea for measuring or actually studying the brain, they relied only on EEG, electroencephalogram. It just gives a graphic picture of your brain pattern. Then PET scan, these technologies, MRI, as somebody pointed out, the magnetic resonance imaging. So those ECG or PET scan, they give only two-dimensional image of your neural system. MRI gives a three-dimensional picture of your brain taken at different slices, different angles. It gives a cubical model. Still advanced technology is fMRI, functional magnetic resonance image. So electrodes are implanted and you can study which part of the brain is actually activated. So they will give you some tasks. Those ancient technologies, they give you only an idea whether there is some infection, some say damage, lesion, or cancer starts with some brain cancer. Anybody? I am struggling to recall that. Initially, it starts with a small defect in the brain.
Starts with
anybody?
Cancerous malignant cells.
Well, benign malignant, yeah, the two different.
Neuroplasticity, sir.
A very common term. I am struggling. Okay.
Traumatic
tumor, sir. Tumor.
Tumor.
Tumor, exactly right. So for detecting something, say, wrong with the brain, those technologies had been used. And you know, brain emits waves, alpha, beta, delta, and all. And those wave patterns can be read looking at the graphic presentation. But fMRI instantly tells you which part of the brain is activated. So electrodes implanted on different lobes. We have occipital, parietal, frontal. All these lobes have the specialized functions. And the frontal lobe, anybody? Frontal, what is its specialty? I am just making you alert. It should not be a passive phenomenon. The frontal part, the frontal lobe is involved in thinking, reasoning, and problem solving.
Cognitive work.
Cognitive, yeah. And the occipital lobe which is at the back of our head.
Vision.
Exactly. And the parietal lobes take care of our
coordination.
Yeah. And even
analysis.
Cerebellum also is involved in coordination of various psychomotor activities. Okay. Now, when you are enjoying some music, these parietal lobes are activated, stimulated, and you can see on the monitor this particular area being shown in a different color. So that is the funny part of fMRI. So you can judge whether this person is pretending to think or is he really seriously thinking about the solution to a particular problem. Or so this part, if when you are given a task, a puzzle, and if this frontal lobe is activated, you can see it on the monitor. And when you are watching some figure, visual information, the occipit is activated. That way, you can instantly measure the functioning of the brain. With this advent of technology, the school of cognitive psychology has reemerged. Mental processes, which were very difficult to study once upon a time, now they are made easy. So that's why cognitive psychology, one of the advanced fields now, is because of the advent of technology. This is how advancement in other sciences can pave the way for growth and development of some other sciences. That is how psychology has benefited from technology. We can study the brain functioning. Nowadays, if you go to a psychiatric ward, fMRI is used whether this brain functioning is sound or not. So that is how the technology has contributed to study even subjective experiences, cognitive processes, which were difficult. Those days, how to check whether this person is really thinking, reasoning, and behaving properly or not? You ask some question, you give him some puzzle, and if he fills that puzzle, yes, this person is thinking, is able, probably, if you are filling a solving a puzzle, sometimes you may go wrong. For example, word puzzle. But it could be an error. But your thought process is in good condition. You may not be knowing the perfect answer, but still. So after all, when you ask your friend, who is your favorite actor or something, that person will give you definitely an actor's name, not a cricketer's name. By that, you can judge, yes, this person is able to think. So that way, word puzzles. So these were actually used to check whether his thought processes are good or normal or affected. Now, with the advent of technology, we can study the mental processes, behavior, which is objective. So that is how these schools of thought contributed in their own form. So structuralism emphasized on the conscious mind, and they used the technique of introspection. Of course, each school of thought gave its own contribution. Functionalism said, structure cannot give you any insight into behavior. Only when it is functioning, only when you are able to adjust to your changes around you in the environment, how your conscious mind helps you adjust and interact effectively, that is how you should understand the behavior, not the structure itself. For example, if you look at a rice mill, it will have pulleys, two or three different sizes of pulleys, and there is a conveyor belt, there is a box, and so many complicated machinery is there. Can you understand how rice is actually processed from the paddy, looking at the structure? Never. Only when you switch on and watch all the pulleys moving in different directions, the conveyor belt connecting those pulleys, and the rice, the paddy is put there, and the husk is separated, and you will get the rice at a separate counter. This is where functionalism has actually, though it also agreed conscious mind only can be studied, but it is how your emotions, memories, and thought help you adjust with the changing environment. That's why it is not a pool, it is not a pond. Consciousness is like a stream. It flows, it changes, it jumps suddenly from present to future, from future to past. So consciousness is not static, it is ever changing. By studying the structure, you can never understand behavior. Only by studying how it enables people to adjust with the environment, that should be the focus. That is for functionalism. Then, of course, Gestalt school, psychoanalysis, behaviorism, humanism, all these schools of thought contributed. And today, we have some schools defunct, structuralism and functionalism. Though their experiments, their contributions are widely used, nowadays, the modern schools of thought try to understand behavior in different perspectives, behavior or personality. I will take a break for 5 minutes. I'll come back. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
5 minutes. Yes. We will assemble, gather here again after 5 minutes break.
Certainly, sir. Thank you.
Hello guys, please let's mute ourselves.
Hello.
Hello, let's mute ourselves. There's somebody who's
Yeah, right.
Who are constantly remain unmuted, and it might be, see, we keep on blurting something or the other in between and it doesn't sound. I mean, he's quite a respectful professor, so we shouldn't disturb him. No offense to anybody in particular, right? Let's mute ourselves.
Before that, hello. Hello, anyone?
Yeah, yes.
Hello. Hi everyone. I just have a doubt. Currently, which topic sir is explaining? Because I joined just now. So,
it is almost like first and second second unit.
I can't hear you.
First and second unit.
Excuse me, everyone. But everything we are talking is on going on YouTube live.
Hello. Please mute yourself, please.
Actually, host can mute everybody, right?
Yeah, we must tell sir to do it.
That way we can't answer if he'll ask us any questions. That's why maybe
we can unmute.
We won't be able to ask any questions.
Even if the host mutes, we can unmute.
Unmute
and unmute. No, we cannot. Host needs to unmute us.
No, we can, I think. We can. In Zoom, we can.
We can.
Yeah.
Well, good morning to you all. I think some people are new over here, so it would be a little bit tough for them to understand how to mute and unmute. So let's ignore the fact. But yes, that's a little bit disturbing as well, so we can understand.
I mean, let's remain mute, yeah. When we require to speak, we can speak. Otherwise, there's always a background sound and I think it would be disturbing for sir.
These classes are being recorded, is it?
Yes.
Somebody mentioned
that. Recorded. Yeah, it is recorded. There is a top red button, no? Recording.
Yeah, but then will it be available for us later? Because this is classes are happening during working hours.
Yeah, we can ask them to share.
They'll upload in the website, I guess.
On YouTube, they are available, I guess. Because live on YouTube.
Currently, YouTube. Live streaming is going on.
Yes, so I guess this class is being recorded and this is a recording live on YouTube. That means you can see it on YouTube anytime.
So welcome back to you all. So here, when you say meaning of psychology, it is a study of behavior. But when you say definition of psychology, not personality, about the psychology, what is your definition? Anybody?
Study of mind.
Yes. Study of human behavior.
Okay.
Integrated study of structure and process.
Study of psyche.
Study of our experiences and behavior.
Okay.
It's purely soul. Soul
study
of
the mental process.
Okay.
Mental processes and behavior in different contexts.
And it's how good. We adapt to the environment and function in the real world.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's purely all of psychology. Soul.
Okay. Yeah. I will give you. Yes. All of you have given. If I combine, blend all these, the definition of psychology goes like this. It is a scientific study of mental processes, experiences, and behavior. Yeah, as I mentioned at the outset, though philosophers have contributed with the term soul, Later on, it was replaced. So that is why I gave the brief historical background also. Now, contemporary or modern definition of psychology. Definition. Meaning of psychology means study of behavior. There is no doubt about that. Definition includes, it includes very minor or all important concepts. That is what a definition is. So that way, it is a scientific study of mental processes. That's what you mean by mind and so on. Then experiences. These are actually experiences as well as emotions, your feelings, and behavior. And here, what is behavior? This is very tricky question. What is behavior?
It is actions, a process, a dynamic process.
Behavior is a dynamic process. Yes. Okay.
Our responses. Any other?
Our responses towards any similar
actions.
Our reaction and our response.
Yeah. So the overt actions.
Response to a stimulus.
Habits. Yes. So responses to stimuli, various responses. Mm. And these responses become habits. See, breaking behavior is habits. And
kindly mute, please.
See, please, others, I give chance for you to speak.
Ma'am, you can put everyone mute, ma'am. The last 5 or 10 minutes, you can unmute everyone for clarification of doubts. Unless until everyone is in mute mode, this problem cannot be solved.
Yeah.
Host has
somebody
got that right,
is,
no?
Please.
That's what, sir. To Priyanka. Avoid all this, host can keep everyone in mute mode, sir, so that these problems can be solved.
No, I don't like it because.
Okay, you wanted an interactive session, right?
Interactive process. Right, because we are all grown up people, matured. And we should know how to behave in a group.
Behave in a class. Correct,
almost,
correct.
Almost all of you are behaving the right way. But there are always some
exceptional cases.
Some people are not aware of technology. They don't know how to do it. So it's okay.
What is psychology?
So please try to follow the norms of classroom learning. Okay? Right. So here, the behavior can be broken into habits, a set of habits become a part of your behavior, and habit can be broken down into responses. If you show a response consistently over a period of time in various situations, that becomes a habit. So if you have the habit of standing up in front of elders or superiors, that is a habit. And when you show these habits in various situations, that is how your behavior is judged as a polite person. Okay, this is how behavior includes all responses, the simplest to the most complex response. Now I am just going very deep only for today. From tomorrow onwards, we'll just discuss the topic wise. Now, if the responses can be observed with our naked eye, that can be judged as so-and-so behavior, polite behavior, mischievous behavior, arrogant behavior, whatever it is. And these responses, when they are shown consistently, they become habits. That way, they become traits also. Apart from the actions, the responses, I said the simplest. What is the most simplest response that can be thought of? What is the simplest, very simple Can you think of any such response?
Reflexes. What is that? Reflexes.
Exactly. I am very happy. Reflexes. They don't need any training, no practice, and they are present by birth. Reflexes. The snake, particularly the cobra, if it is hurt, instantly it will raise its hood. That is its reflex. And it is not actually learned. It is not the product of learning. It is present by birth. It is an instinct, we call. And in the humans, we have a number of reflexes. Best example is the foot sole reflex. A baby, just newly born, 1 week or probably 1 month old, asleep, you scratch the foot sole. The baby, without being disturbed from sleep, would withdraw the foot. Mother has not taught the baby. Nobody has the chance to tell that you have to withdraw if your foot is scratched. You know, the child, the infant doesn't understand also. This is present as an instinct by birth. So that is the simplest form of behavior, reflex, very good. And there are moderately complex responses. See, for a small child, putting the right foot into the right shoe is moderately complex. Sometimes the children are fumbled. They insert the right one into the left shoe and they learn later on. And complex response. Swimming is a complex response till you learn. Operating a computer is a moderately complex. And for me, probably is more complex. And the most complex, probably, piloting a spacecraft. Very complex response. All these responses form behavior. They can be brought under the aspect of behavior. And there is very important part, apart from actions that go with behavior. Can anybody think of it? It is also a part of behavior. In fact, it is sometimes very powerful.
Cognitive process. Cognitive.
Motivation.
Motivation.
Drive.
Okay.
Drive.
No, that is actually, it is a state. Drive is a state.
Sir, I didn't get the question actually.
There is an important aspect apart from actions, which would be a part of our behavior. It need not be an action.
Expressions.
Feelings, emotions.
Happiness.
Like smile.
Tears. That is nonverbal. Nonverbal. Yeah, yeah.
Imitation. Tears. Imitation comes.
No. Language.
Gestures.
No, language.
Language.
Words are so powerful. You are either respected or probably beaten, attacked by the words you use. Same person, if he uses a very sophisticated, very cultured language, he is respected as a doctor, teacher, or engineer, whatever it is. If this person uses a foul language, people won't tolerate. Whether it is criticizing a caste or religion or somebody's performance, yes, it will infuriate people. That's why all our actions, yes, language, the speech is brought under behavior. Okay? This is worth studying about behavior. For today, there is some 9 minutes time left. If anybody has doubts or even contribute, if something...
Sir, can you tell us how we will be proceeding from tomorrow onwards? How will you go about...
I will stick to the syllabus. I'll explain whatever is mentioned in the material.
Okay.
And apart from that, wherever I think would be useful to you, I will add that also.
Okay.
And if you can have a look at the first chapter for tomorrow, make a rough study, bird's eye view tomorrow. Probably my class would be more easy to understand. Otherwise, if I am telling something which is very strange to you, then probably you won't be comfortable. So not only this particular paper, any subject, if you just make a brief study, at least the gist summary, then you have some doubts, I will be happy to clarify. If I cannot clarify, I will check, find the correct information. At least in the next class, I will give the correct information to you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir. My question is totally out of context. Who is the father of psychology, sir? Some say it's Freud. Some say it's William Wundt.
I think you missed the early part of my lecture. It is Wilhelm Wundt. There is no doubt.
Father of psychology is William Wundt only, sir.
Yes. Americans claim that it is William James. But he only framed the theory part pertaining to sensory processes in 1875. Though Wilhelm Wundt started his laboratory in 1879, 4 years after William James, his study was scientific. He studied the sensations, memory, affective states in the laboratory using the method of introspection. He studied phenomena related to behavior. So, Wilhelm Wundt is the father of psychology.
So then Sigmund Freud is the father of modern psychology?
Psychoanalysis.
Psychoanalysis? Yeah, about psychoanalysis, what was your doubt, madam?
Is Sigmund Freud a modern father of psychologist?
No. Sigmund Freud is not a psychologist at all. He was a neurologist. And his school of thought, that is psychoanalysis, has certain drawbacks. And it is not the first school or the founder. He was not the founder of psychology, definitely not. For modern psychology, there are different schools. Relatively modern school is humanism, by Carl Rogers and Abraham Maslow. Then cognitive psychology also. It is one of the recent schools. Though mental processes, what we study and cognition, have been given importance by early psychologists also, only with the advent of technology, cognitive psychology could be re-established. Because earlier there were no scientific gadgets to study mental processes. But now technology has given that facility to study brain functions, mental activities and all. That also is recent.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. Before we bid farewell or close the class, there are some print mistakes. I had gone through the material. It is only mistake at the proofreading, not the writer's mistake. But still, I just want to page number 2, introduction 1.1. The 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6th line. That means a person maybe have an aggressive personality. You strike off B there, B, B, you strike off. That means a person may have an aggressive personality. Got it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, page 2, line 6. Strike off B. The person may have an aggressive personality. Then, 6, 7, 8th line. Impression created. You delete created. That sentence reads like this. In each of these cases, an observer selects an attribute or quality that is highly typical of the subject that is going to create an overall impression created. You remove that, delete that created. It is not necessary. Overall impression in others. Got it?
So line number?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Line number
8th line. Impressions created. You delete created. Because already create is used before that. Again, no need of repetition there. You delete created. Strike off. Impression created in others. And in the very next line, it is clear. You add that there. It is clear that there is an element of evaluation.
Yes, sir.
It is clear. After that, you add that. VHOT. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Now, from the bottom, 1, 2, 3, fourth line, from the bottom, the modern psychologist stresses, the personality pattern of the modern psychologist stresses that it is something that can be objectively observed. D is missing there. That can be objectively observed. We add D to that. Observed in the speech and actions. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. One more mistake on the same page. Second line from the bottom. The traditional beliefs. You can delete the D there. To disprove the traditional beliefs, psychologists have proved that learning and identity together make up the personality pattern. You delete the D. No need of D there. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right, it is exactly 12 now. We must be having another class after this.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Enter it.
Sir.
Sir, for tomorrow's class, can you explain elaborately on structure and process of personality, sir?
Yeah, I am going to take up that only tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Briefly about...
Yeah, that is a bit difficult. I'm not really able to follow from the book, sir.
Right.
If you can do it.
There are concepts relating to the aspects of personality, dynamic or psychophysical systems. If you want those terms also be explained, I will just focus on that. Then nature of personality, definitely. We will nature and functions also
structure,
tomorrow.
Structure, process. structure and process are there. Thank you, sir.
Okay, all of you, good day. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Good day, all of you.
Good day, sir, to you also.
Thank you.
Bye.